Ready? Good morning, everyone. I'm a mysterious voice. You can't see me unless you look behind. Welcome to worship this Palm Sunday. Welcome to Holy Week. Thank you so much for joining us today. As you can tell, we've got a little special something as we process with palms. So, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. A reading from Mark, chapter 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of the Lord. Please rise. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today, he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that, joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you. Through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us go forth in peace. Amen. Our processional hymn is 344, All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Thank you. Let us join in the prayer of the day. Everlasting God, in your endless love to the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives
and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God,
now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Please join us in singing Prepare the Way.
morning. The first reading is taken from the 50th chapter of the book of Isaiah, beginning at the 4th verse. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The second reading is taken from the second chapter of the book of Philippians, beginning at the 5th verse. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Here end the readings.
Oh.
assembly may be seated. I just wanted to wake you up a little bit. In honor of Passion and Palm Sunday together, we have decided to present the Passion according to St. Mark as a dramatic reading. Now, we have a number of volunteers here, but they can only cover so many lines. So at different portions of the reading, you will see a cue line come up on the slideshow, which is the line before what you all are invited to say. You all are the crowd. There are sections of the Passion where a large number of people are speaking all at the same time, and it just doesn't have the same effect if a large number of people aren't speaking at the same time. It'll make sense as we go. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Mark. It was 3 days before the Passover, and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
"Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people."
While he was at Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard, and she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
"Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii, and the money given to the poor."
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go
and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out and went into the city and found everything as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and said to him, one after another,
"Surely not I."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
Even though all become deserters, I will not.
Jesus said to him,
Truly, I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he said vehemently,
Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
Sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated, and said to them,
I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake.
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want.
He came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there were a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said,
Rabbi,
and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at their fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another. Not made with hands.
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard this blasphemy. What is your decision?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him,
"Prophesy."
The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servants of the high priest came by. When they saw Peter warming himself, they stared at him and said,
"You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you're talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean."
But he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know this man you are talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
And he broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized it was out of jealousy that the chief priest had handed him over. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate said to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to be crucified. Please rise. Please rise. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes amongst them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha, You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves, saying,
He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe.
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
Eloi, Eloi, lima sabachthani,
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
Listen, he is calling for Elijah.
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down.
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said,
Truly, this man was God's son.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, the younger, and of Jesus, and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before Passover, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council who also himself was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he was already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth, and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn from the rock. He rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of Jesus saw where the body was laid. The passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. You may be seated. All right, let me use this one because my headset is doing its normal thing. Hello, you can leave those on the ground. Oh, thank you. Although, we are not sitting, we are once again going to walk up here. But before we do, before we cross this little line, I need you all to make a promise. Can you promise not to touch anything back here? The only stuff you're allowed to touch are your shoes to the carpet. All right? You do that already? All right. Yeah, just feet on the carpet, nothing else to touch. Okay, I think we're getting a little specific. That's fair. So, everyone can come up here to the front of the altar because I just talked a whole lot and my throat kind of hurts because that was a lot of talking. That was a very long story, wasn't it? Now, at the very end of the story, I'm not going to quiz you on it, because I know, even though you are all paying such good attention, that was a lot of stuff to hear. But does anyone remember who were the two people that saw where Jesus was buried? I'll give you a hint. They are up here. That's why we're up here. Well, yes, Jesus was up there, but who were the two people that saw where Jesus was buried? Out of all these people, only two of them. Yeah, it's a big number. I'll give you a hint. They're in the top row. So out of those 24 people, only two saw where Jesus was buried. I'll give you another hint. It's the top row. Mary. Although you have to be specific. Which one? That one. Yes, that's how you spell Mary. So, Mary, the one on the left is Mary, mother of Jesus. Yes. So, Mary, the mother of Jesus. So, Jesus' mom saw where he was buried. Who's the other person? Her name, the last part of her name, that, there's another hint. It's a girl. She, her last name is a little hard to pronounce for us, maybe. But you already know her first name. She's standing right next to Mary, mother of Jesus. It is! So that says Magdalene, which just means that she was from a place called Magdala. And guess what her first name is? You did know it. I'm very impressed. Mary. Yeah, her name was Mary. So out of all these people up here, only two of them saw where Jesus was buried. And guess what they do later on Easter? Well, no, Jesus kind of unburies himself. He does. And guess who was the first to realize that he rose? Yep, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was one of the first. But Mary Magdalene was the very first person to find out that Jesus had risen. And I think that's kind of neat because we don't hear a whole lot about them. And I think it's also really cool that they're the ones closest to the cross, right? Even Peter and John are like a little further away than the two Marys are. So I think that's kind of neat. We can all remember that the Marys were with Jesus the entire time. Thank you all so much. I know you just sat through a whole bunch of talking. Feel free to get a little treat on your way back to your seats. All right. Well, I think that's it. And together we sing our hymn 521, O Day of Rest and Gladness.
Thank you. will be received when we receive our offering. Also invite you to hear that for the end, so the pastor will be able to pass.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and for a world in need. Blessed One, today your church sings glad hosannas as we enter Holy Week. Prepare us to bear witness to Christ's suffering and death endured for our sake. Gather your people around the cross and comfort us with resurrection hope. Lord, in your mercy, renew your good creation. Protect the balance of life on earth. Encourage all who work for the well-being of creation. We pray for the health of insects, songbirds, and native plants, and all that you have made. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for peace and justice among the nations, especially those places torn apart by warfare. Hold all to account with authority to judge others. Help all who serve to serve with integrity and compassion. Lord, in your mercy, bring hope to any who feel forsaken or forgotten. Make way for those who wander. Reunite families enduring separation. We pray for those who are incarcerated or in any kind of care situation, that they may know your love. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we lift up before you our friends and neighbors who stand in need of your healing touch and your comfort. We pray for Max, Susan, Warren, Tony, Margaret, Paul and Lois, Paul, Ingrid, Dolores, Sarah, Terry, John and his family, Linda, Ken, Nick, Steve, Joyce, Allison, Kara, Joan, Todd, Norm, Lincoln, Mary Jane, Bonnie, Ginger, Dolores, Mackenzie, Brock, Jeannie, Mike, Grace, Carol, and any others we name in our hearts before you. Lord, in your mercy, accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Well, before we go today, we actually have a minute. Let's take a minute and greet those you worship with. If you're comfortable leaving your seat, just nod at people. But if you want to take a minute and find someone to say hi to, please do that. I always do it, but it's good to see folks here on this day. I get you. You set them all loose, and it's like getting cats back in the barn here. I don't know. So glad you could join us for Palm Sunday. It seems like so much of the rest of the world only calls this the first Sunday of spring break. It seems like, you know, every other person I talked to this week was going somewhere else, you know. So I'm always glad to see people are still here. You know, I have no big plans. The farthest south I've ever gone during spring break is Chicago. I don't know if that counts. It's all relative. Anyway, just a reminder of the rest of Holy Week's schedule. We do have Monday, Thursday services at 11 in the morning in the Fellowship Hall, 7 p.m. here in the evening. Our Good Friday worship this year is at the United Methodist Church at 1 o'clock for the Seven Last Word service. Just a reminder, some of you grew up when I did, when that service went for 3 hours. Few of you nodding knowingly. I remember being a fourth grader and sitting in this church waiting for it ever to get home. It goes a little over an hour anymore. Don't be scared off by the Seven Last Words. So that's at 1 o'clock. We're at the United Methodist Church this year, so you can join us for that. And then next Sunday, we have our early worship at 7 a.m., and then our regular worship at 9 a.m. Our youth are serving a breakfast in the fellowship hall during that time as well. So please come celebrate Easter with us next Sunday. We still do have one session of our Lenten Bible study today after worship. One very important announcement. Check your cupboards. Mary Meister's metal baking pan is missing since last Wednesday. Somebody took it home. I say it's important because if we don't return it, she won't bring us any more brownies. No, I'm sure it just got misplaced, but if you find it, please get it back to her. I also want to, I know this is hard to believe, I know Sandy didn't agree with this, but Sandy has an announcement in that Sandy Glavy back here, I know it's hard to believe looking at her, but she's a great grandmother this week. Her grandson Dylan has a new baby boy, Stanley Jack Pudo. So please congratulate her. Other announcements, joys, or concerns? Oh, yes. If you have not yet signed up for your directory pictures, there'll be a table out in the narthex. The instructions are also in your bulletin to do it at home. We'd like to get as many people signed up as soon as possible so we know we got enough spots for everybody. Anybody else? Not then, let's receive the blessing. May the blessing of God, our Creator, the love of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, and the presence of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, surround you and sustain you until we gather again. Our closing hymn is number 338.
and speed cigar.